Today's Washing Tech episode is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at washingtech.com/book. Over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. And also Warby Parker. Get a free 5-day home try-on at warbyparkertrial.com/joe. 5 pairs, 5 days, and the try-on is 100% free. That's warbyparkertrial.com/joe.
If you're doing the right thing, then you shouldn't feel attacked. There are two types of white people, right? There are people who so happen to be white, and then there are white people.
Welcome to the Washing Tech Tech Policy Podcast. We deliver the latest tech policy news and brightest tech policy experts to you. Wherever you are, so you can stay productive, relevant, and informed in less time. From Washington, D.C., it's the Washing Tech Tech Policy Podcast with Joe Miller.
Facebook couldn't really get in front of the New Zealand shooting and failed to remove some 20% of videos of the massacre. Arlington County approves Amazon incentives, and Alisa Valentin is my guest. Facebook failed to block some 20% of videos showing the shooting in New Zealand, including videos that praised the shooting. That's some 300,000 videos. The company reports, though, that it did manage to take down some 1.2 million videos related to a white supremacist's massacre of 50 worshippers at two mosques in Christchurch, New Zealand. Arlington County, Virginia, has approved $23 million in incentives for Amazon to put its second headquarters in Crystal City. Protesters attended an Arlington County board meeting to oppose the vote, saying the county should focus on affordable housing before Amazon. Opponents are also concerned about traffic congestion and school overcrowding. The Arlington chapter of the NAACP also opposed certain aspects of the incentive package, but the county board unanimously approved the incentives with a 5-0 vote. So again, just like in Queens, very superficial engagement by Amazon to reach out to the local community or even include them in negotiations. Extremely poor stakeholder engagement. And they do it. Why do they do it? Because they can. Facebook has reinstated Senator Elizabeth Warren's ads calling for a breakup of the social media giants along with Google and Amazon. A company spokesman says it removed the ads because they violated a policy regarding the use of Facebook's logo, even though the whole point of that type of policy is obviously to prevent ads going up that criticize the company, right? Right. Finally, Apple is defending its App Store policies against Spotify after Spotify filed a complaint against Apple in Europe for allegedly engaging in anti-competitive behavior by setting its cost to carry the Spotify app in the App Store too high. Apple currently charges 30% for anything sold in the App Store. Apple says Spotify is simply seeking to avoid paying the same fee everyone else pays. Events we've got on Wednesday, March 20th, this coming Wednesday at the Federal Trade Commission, a hearing on competition and consumer protection in U.S. broadband markets. That's at the Constitution Center at 407th Street Northwest from 9 a.m. to 5:45 p.m. again on Wednesday. And then next Monday, the 25th of March, we've got Public Knowledge Georgetown and Good Friend Group doing a presentation, an event on algorithmic exclusion and data deserts, which you'll hear a little more about in Alisa Valentin's interview coming up in a few minutes. And then that's at Georgetown University Law Center at 600 New Jersey Avenue Northwest. And that's from 3:30 to 5:30. And again, that's next Monday, March 25th. And you can find links to all these stories, plus the events and registration links in the show notes. And you can find us at Washing Tech on Twitter. And in our show notes, you can find links and dates as well. Stay with us. For Washing Tech Tech Policy Podcast listeners, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. You can listen at the gym, in the car, or on your morning run. How about Native Son by Richard Wright? You can download Native Son free by trying audible.com. Sign up for your free audiobook and 30-day trial today at washingtech.com/book.
You're plugged into the Washing Tech Tech Policy Podcast, the inclusive voice of tech policy.
I like that. My guest today is Alisa Valentin, Communications Justice Fellow at Public Knowledge, where she focuses on digital inclusion policies for communities of color and policies that diversify media ownership. Prior to joining Public Knowledge, Alisa served as an intern in the office of Commissioner Mignon Clyburn at the Federal Communications Commission and as a legislative fellow for Congresswoman Yvette D. Clarke. Alisa was also an adjunct professor at several D.C. area colleges and universities where she taught communications and women's studies courses. Alisa received her Ph.D. in communications from Howard. She also earned her B.S. from the University of Florida and an M.S. from Northwestern. Please welcome Alisa Valentin. Alisa, finally, it's good to have you on. We've been trying to get you on for a while now, going back and forth a few weeks, so we were finally able to work that out.
Yes, thank you, Joe. It's great to be here.
So you joined Public Knowledge, one of my favorite organizations here in town, by the way, home of the great Harold Feld, Chris, Gene, John, Meredith. Too many names to mention. Really, really, really receptive organization.
Yeah, you know, it's been great. I started here in July of 2018, and I'm the first Communications Justice Fellow, and it's really been amazing. I definitely love the folks who work here. Definitely love the fellows that are here as well, Dylan, Lindsay, and Jane. It's been great.
So what are you working on?
I'm working on a lot of issues, honestly. Everything has a social justice angle, whether that be broadband access or privacy or intellectual property. So the great thing about this fellowship is that I've been involved in a lot of those different areas, and I'm learning a lot of new things every single day. But what I can say is taking up most of my time is the Broadband Connects America Rural Broadband Coalition. So I've been doing a lot of that work, and I also have two big events coming up. One is next Monday, March 25th. PK is teaming up with the Institute for Technology Law and Policy at Georgetown Law, as well as the Good Friend Group. And we're having an event called Algorithmic Exclusion, How Data Deserts in the U.S. Perpetuate Inequity. And also on May 2nd, I'm organizing an event called Emerging Tech for Social Change, which will take place on Capitol Hill. And it's an all-day event, and we're focused on issues related to artificial intelligence, the Internet of Things, virtual reality, and 3D printing. And we're looking at how all of those technologies can be used for social good. So my goal with that event is to center voices at the margin. So we're going to make sure that we have a lot of diverse panels that raise policy concerns that we haven't normally heard.
Yeah, I'm planning to be there too, so hope to see everyone Perfect. There. So I want to turn now to your recent post entitled Tech Policy So White on the PK blog. And when I saw it on PK, I was like, wow, these folks are serious.
Yes, definitely. Definitely.
You said it's time to pass the mic or wait, how about this? How about we have the mic and we'll pass it?
Okay.
So not everyone's read the article yet. So we've got it for you guys in the show notes, but you say there's kind of this subjectiveness that's missing from a lot of tech policy debates.
Yeah. So, you know, as a person of color, and I'm sure a lot of folks can relate, you know, when I walk in to rooms, you know, whether that be a restaurant or a meeting or an event, I always kind of do a scan of the room to see who in there looks like me, right? And so for the past 5 years, I've been in a PhD program at Howard University, and I've been teaching at a lot of colleges and universities where there's a large population of people of color. So I'm very used to walking in a room and knowing there's going to be people who look like me. And then when I made this transition over to tech policy, that is not really the case as much. So I'll walk in the room and there will be a couple of people who look like me, and they're my friends, like Yosef Getachew from Common Cause or Zachary Ryan from NHMC. And I'm always thinking, you know, where is everyone else at? And so not to say there aren't people of color who are in this space, I just think that it's important for our voices to be centered more. And, you know, when we're having conversations about, you know, privacy or broadband access, you know, these are issues that really impact people of color and women in different and more adverse ways. And it's just a little concerning when we have, you know, panels that have, you know, all white men that are talking about these various issues. So that's where this kind of blog came out of.
So what are your thoughts for people who feel hurt by that language, who feel like they're being attacked for being white, even if they don't remotely consider themselves racist, or let's be even more specific, they're actively anti-racist, like they work and protest against racism, or maybe they don't even identify as white per se. What are your thoughts for them? How can they think about some of that self-consciousness that can set in when they're the only, you know, this is kind of a small group of folks I know, but some of these folks are really woke as fuck. And sometimes that's got to feel isolating.
Yeah, for sure. So I think that, you know, honestly, if you're doing the right thing, then you shouldn't feel attacked. And I have to quote Amanda Seales, who I absolutely love. You know, she says that there are two types of white people, right? There are people who so happen to be white, and then there are white people. So she says people who so happen to be white understand that whiteness is a construct created only to oppress. And those people use their privilege that comes out of that construct to give access to marginalized people who don't inherently already have that access. And then Amanda Seales says that the definition of white people are those who believe that white is supreme and that constructs make them better. So I would say at PK and in the larger tech policy space, we have people who so happen to be white, right? So the folks here at Public Knowledge are really supportive of the work that I'm doing. You know, our president, Gene Kimmelman, our chief of staff, Christine DeBry, they've really listened to the ideas that I present to PK. And they've had an amazing fellowship program here that's really, really diverse. They hire diverse interns. They listen to my ideas about including more HBCU students and that sort of a thing. So they really respect my opinions. And that's why I really love working here at Public Knowledge.
Yeah, and sometimes they check us when we need it. Sometimes we need it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Harold checked me the other day. It's fine. I need it. It's needed. And sometimes you have folks who look like us who are even more out of touch than a lot of these other folks.
Yeah, that happened. You know, I'm just going to kind of sip the tea on that one. You know, I know that some people say, you know, all skin folk ain't kin folk. So I'll just let that be that.
Well, Alisa, it's been great having you on. There's so much toxicity now, I think, in the racial debate that's happening. Lots of fear, lots of fighting it hard, I think, to either avoid being grouped in with folks who are carrying out acts of racism and violence or avoid being ostracized for speaking out in a way that's unconventional or colloquial. And frankly, I'm not talking about hate speech or, you know, like veiled hate speech rhetoric. I'm really talking about being authentic, you know, not inciting hatred. And I think progressives and conservatives especially, could often think more before they speak.
Oh, yes, for sure. Absolutely. I 100% agree.
Now let's turn to your icebreaker, your career hack, and your pick for our book this week. Okay, so it's time for this week's icebreaker. Ready?
Absolutely.
Okay, tell me about a lifetime goal you want to achieve.
A lifetime goal that I want to achieve. I want to start a tech policy research center at my alma mater, Howard University. I really think it's important to have an HBCU as a space for, you know, thought leaders in tech policy. So that's one of my major goals. Maybe it'll happen, you know, before I can actually do it, but I definitely want it to happen during my lifetime.
I have a growing list. Literally, I'm making a list of 100 goals. I was up to 52 this morning, but I'd say the number one thing is a pilot's license, like Bigger Thomas and Richard Wright's native son. It's been a goal for too long, and I really need to make that happen. How do you stay productive?
I would say Google Calendar is life. I write down everything on my calendar, whether that's blocking off time to work on a research proposal or giving a 15-minute call to someone. So I would say Google Calendar is the key.
I've been procrastinating so much lately on unpleasant tasks, and it's tax season. These taxes. I feel like I'm just like paying for Mar-a-Lago catering or something. Anyway, tell us about a book you're reading these days.
Yeah, so my brother is a PhD student now at Rice University, and he passes off a lot of books to me. Well, he's done that like since we were kids, but he still does it now. And one of those books is Racial Taxation by Camille Walsh. And this book looks at the idea of like taxpayer identity. So a lot of times when you hear the rhetoric of, you know, oh, we're the taxpayers and that sort of a thing, it seems to equate to taxpayer equaling white, and that's not the case. So essentially, this book is looking at the identity and how it contributes to larger racial disparities. And I'm just at the beginning of the book. I used to spend a lot of my time on the metro reading, but now it seems like I'm answering emails and then missing my metro stop. But I definitely want to get back to it. So yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely not just white people paying taxes. So I mentioned Richard Wright's Native Son earlier because I just finished it. It's just gut-wrenching. It's hard to get through. Powerful book, though. He wrote it in 1940, but a lot of the resentment about white folks, in this case, well-meaning white folks, I think really rings true today when we talk about how in touch they are if they enjoy the fruits of the continued oppression of people of color. It was too much to read almost. So I had to follow it up with something a little more uplifting. So I decided to reread Trevor Noah's book.
Actually, it's funny you say that because I think last week I was on the metro and I saw a white guy reading Trevor Noah's book. So I was like, okay, now I need to make sure I read it too.
So what are some takeaways you'd like to leave with us before we close, and where can we find you?
I would say the major takeaways are that when, you know, you see an injustice, you've got to call it out. When you see that something can be improved, you've got to speak up. And also, don't be afraid to be your authentic self. And you can find me on Twitter, Facebook, and everything else at Alisa Valentin. And it's Valentin, not Valentine. So no E at the end.
You've been listening to Alisa Valentin, Communications Justice Fellow at Public Knowledge. Alisa, thanks for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me.
And that concludes episode 178 of the podcast. Thanks for listening. If you like what we do here, we'd love to hear from you. Please take a moment. Head over to Apple Podcasts. Give it a review. It helps others know what they can expect from the show and really helps us out. Thanks again for listening, and I'll see you back here next week. Take care.
Washing Tech.